Okay, thank you. At the outset, I must thank all of you to invite me here. Mrs. Deshpande, Principal Ma'am, General Anil, and Flight Lieutenant Shivali, the teacher staff, and my dear cadets. I consider it a proud privilege and a unique honor to be here with you today, especially on the one of the very famous occasions of the Kargil Vijay Diwas, which is tomorrow. This day marks one of the very famous milestones in the history of independent India. And there is no other parallel in the history of warfare till today like this action, which was carried out by the Indian Army, by its young officers, jawans, and the supporting arms. The Prahar school, which was started by Colonel Deshpande, I know him personally, and I have been following the leaps which this school has taken, especially so where this is being started in a Vidarbha region, which is one of the most neglected regions in Maharashtra. And we hardly had any knowledge or any introduction to the armed forces. And I think this gap was filled by the school. I had another coincident relations with late Colonel Deshpande. His unit was very famous in 1965 for the Husainwala battle. And my unit was also famous for Husainwala battle, but in 1971 war. And rest of the things, my unit replaced his unit in Sundarbani. Of course, by that time he had left. Having said that, I feel before giving out my speech that I want to tell you cadets that we have played our innings. And I think it was a good innings played. And now it is up to you to take it forward. Our nation is a great nation which has got resources, both in terms of material as well as human resources. It's got vast area, excellent geographical location. And with all this, as the PM says, hamara desh maha shakti banne ki aukaat rakhta hai. And this is, cadets, in your hands. Now with this, in next 35 minutes or so, I'll deliver lecture in two phases. In first phase, I will tell you some of my experiences of my army life, which will give some kind of a lesson to you. And in second phase, I'll tell you about the surgical strike worry, which everybody wanted me to tell you exactly as to what had happened, what are the myths, what are the facts of this operation called surgical strike or Black Thunder. Coming on to some of the experiences. See, army life, as you say, is not only bed of roses. No, a lot of civilians only see us. They say you only do parties and you dance and you think this is not the life. This is a small portion of it. And there are 90% portion which is hidden. It's very, very difficult, but equally satisfying. I'll tell you, right from the, I got about 5 to 6 experiences in my 51 years of uniform service. I joined the uniform at the age of 9 years and then retired the age after continuously being in uniform there. So when I got commissioned, my first posting was in area of Sela Bumla. I think all of you had gone there in Bumla last year and you know what kind of a terrain it is. And when I was there in 1979, there was no army there. Army was only restricted to Tenga Valley. And then we used to carry out the patrolling in the far-flung areas on the Chinese and Bhutan borders. And the patrolling used to last for about 25 days, 30 days, maybe 1 month. And we had to carry everything along with us. So if you have to carry all rations for 30 days, each man normally has to carry the weight about 30 to 35 kgs. And then carry it and go to climb the heights, which are quite dangerous. And there is a danger to life as well as limb. Now, in one of the long-range patrol like this, when I was moving to the Bhutan border, inaccessible area, there is a place, small village called Rahung beyond Bomdila, and then we had to climb up. So we should start early in the morning because in east, the sun sets very fast, and therefore you have to stop there and rest for the day or night. So when we started in the morning, by about lunchtime, maybe about 11:30, we reached the village, and then we are tired and we wanted to have a lunch. So we had lunch just next to the village. And the village was of the strength of about houses, about 150 houses or maybe 200 max. And it was sitting pretty on the precipice of a hill. And we had lunch, and then we walked off. The moment we crossed the village, about 500 meters from the village, when we crossed the Nala, we heard a terrible sound, rumbling, very heavy rumbling, of which we had never heard earlier. And when we turned back, we saw the whole hill coming down. And that then we realized how the landslide, how hill collapses like a pack of cards. And the entire hill went on the village, and the village was totally engulfed. We could not see the village. At one moment, the village was there. At second moment, it was not there at all. And we actually were saved by the skin of our teeth. If it had been there 5 minutes before, then we also would have been buried underneath. When it also, this landslide stopped after about 10 minutes or so, and then we turned back. Then we wanted to help the villages. But how much we can help? Because we have to dig out the whole mountain. It is not an easy task. But whatever we could do, we were about 15 of us. We with our hands and some instruments we carry like pick and shovel for digging the bunker. So with that, whatever we could do, manage to save about 35 men and women. And that was it. And rest, all of them unfortunately died. But we are quite satisfied with the fact that at least we saved about 35 people. Then after that, when we took a counter, we wanted to go. And we could, from a distance, we could hear a sound of a small child. And when we looked at it, at a far distance, at about 150, 200 meters, we saw a small girl, maybe about 7-8 years of age. She was weeping, and she was on a cliff. Now the cliff was formed by the coming out of the mountain. And there was no way to go near her. If you had to go down and climb up, because those who have seen that area, you see how difficult. It would have taken us 8 to 9 hours. Now, in that 8 to 9 hours, definitely this girl would have died. Then how do you do? So I as a leader, you have to make a very important decision, very fateful decision in your life. As a second lieutenant, with 20 years of age, I was faced with this dilemma as to what to do. My Havaldar is a fairly senior rank in the Indian armies, Jawan lost. So he was about 18, 20 years of service, and he was my second in command. He was helping me. So he was telling me, and my unit is fully sick, all sick personnel are there. So he's telling me, Saab, is bacche ko bachana chahiye. So I said, hum kaise bacha sakte isko? Apan niche chahiye. He said, nahi Saab, ek tarika hai kya? Those of you know that in the army, we have got something called anchor. When we want to breach the minefield, we throw it, pull it, and the mine goes away. So that we carry out whenever you want to climb a peak, then you want to, that is, there are 4 or 5 hooks. So you throw it, it anchors there, and then we climb with the help of it. So he says, if you can throw that distance and it sticks, then we have an anchor onto that side, and we tie it up, and then we have something called a monkey rope. With that we go, and he says, we will bring it. So then we had a better idea. We had a pioneer, like engineer platoon guys we have. They said, we have a carabiner. We'll latch the carabiner onto the rope, and then we can, with the carabiner latch, we can get this girl. But I had my doubts, because the precipice, the cliff was very virgin. It had just been formed. I didn't know how much weight it will take, whether it will carry the weight of the soldier and the baby. And and even if it takes, then there is a danger that the jawan or the girl might die, or both of them might die. But contrary to my decision, because that was only, I had again decided not to go with the plan. But my jawans, sometimes you get the strength from your jawans also. They said, the saab nahi isko bachana hai hamare bachchu ko. I said, there is a loss to them. But anyway, finally, long and short of it, that we decided to save this girl. We threw the anchor. Fortunately, it anchored in the third attempt. Very difficult to throw anchor, land for a distance. You know, if it's from here to throw to that gate, it is very, very difficult to, and especially it should hook also. But fortunately, God was with us and hooked, and it was a solid anchor. And we tied this side, and the Hawaldar himself had volunteered. He says, I will go. So he went to the carabiner. He could go there. He tied the carabiner to the girl, and girl came. Now, when the girl came, unfortunately, those of you who are technical will find that because of some equilibrium loss, or there is a change in equilibrium, the whole cliff came down. The girl was saved, but this jawan died. This one who insisted that this baby must be saved, he died. But I got a strain from other jawan. He says, "Aap, ye toh hamara kaam tha. Wo mar gaya toh koi baat nahi hai. Lekin humne ek bachchi ko bataya, hamesha hamare jindagi ke sabse bada tohfa hoga." So in this, at a very young age, you get such instances where you have to show your leadership and take a decision, wrong or right. And that is what the Indian Army is all about. This is my first brush with taking decisions. Second is, I was a major in the famous area which you've seen in this photographs, in the border of Daras and Kaksar. We were, unfortunately, Pakistan had intruded long time back in 1948-49, and they had been holding on to a post at the height of about 15,000 feet. And you've seen how the precipices are there. You've seen the rifleman Sanjay Kumar, how he climbed. So that post had to be attacked. Now, when you go for attack, especially in those areas, firstly on the heights, the oxygen is very less. Climbing without any weight also is a problem. It's very difficult. And if you go for attack, you have to carry your ammunition, you have to carry your water. These two things, ration might fetch up later. It makes each man carry about 35 to 40 kgs of weight. 35, 40 is carrying another human being. When you yourself can't go to that height, no, without any weight, it is very difficult. Now carrying, you imagine how difficult it is. Anyway, so we had decided, my company, I was a company commander. We are about 55 people, and we are tasked to go there. Now when we, that was a virgin area we were climbing, it was very difficult to go in one night. So for the first night, we laid the ropes. Again, similar, we had to, there it is difficult to go walking. You have to most of the time do rock climbing. So we, first party went, put the ropes there, we climbed, then the ropes had to be removed, because early in the morning, if the enemy is sitting on the top, and if he sees that somebody is coming, then he doesn't need ammunition. He can just use the stones and kill you with the stones itself. Neither you can go up nor go down. So the important thing was to remove the ropes and make sure that none of you are seen. And therefore, throughout the day, when you have to hide, imagine how difficult. Each minute is like one day. Just sitting out there in the sun. So that was, I think, one of the worst days in my life ever saw. We had to sit down throughout the day, and there are attendant difficulties with it. When you go throughout the day, you know what all you have to do. You have to go for the nature's call. You have to eat. You have to urinate. You don't have a luxury like this. If you eat, the eagles will come. And once the eagle concentrate or cross concentrate in a particular space, then the attention is diverted. Therefore, you cannot eat. If you have to do a nature's call, then again similar thing. So what we found a method, we took out our socks, and all the excreta was collected in socks and kept behind. And the urination was done in a tin, some tin we carry, the urination was done in those tins so that the birds cannot come. And therefore, and all the time worried if somebody sees, then you are dead. So it is called that Democles' sword is hanging on our head. Actually, it is hanging on our head. So throughout the day, we spent like this. And then we, next day, we climbed by about 3:30 in the morning, we reached the top, and Pakistan in that time, we can say they were, like we have a phrase in English, we call they were caught with their pants down. Literally, they were caught with their pants down. They didn't know what hit them. And they only ran. All of them ran away. We killed about six of them. And rest of them ran away, captured the post. And then after that, the whole this thing started. So that was in 1988, we did this action. What I'm to do with this, we carried second incident in that area. Now this post was very small and we had to make it big for our jawans. 55 jawans can't stay in 3 or 4 bunkers. We had to make bunkers. And there is another post on top of it of Pakistanis. They could see us very clearly. And then we started building the bunkers in the night. In one, and we are about 55, as I said, plus 56, and differentiated about 10 to 12 bunkers which are half constructed. And we had to move from one bunker to another for various administrative jobs, etc. So in one of the last bunkers, there was one boy, I still remember his name, Surmukh Singh. In the early in the morning, a sniper hit him, and it hit on his head. But unfortunately, instead of going perpendicular, it went parallel. And he was bruised, but he was bleeding very profusely. He could not see. And he was howling. The top was a mar gaya, you know. Now you cannot go. You cannot go near him, because if you go, then you are surely dead. Now there is again a dilemma as a leader. What do you do? If you don't evacuate him and he dies, then all jawans will say, ye toh hume toh marne ke liye chhod de, idhar koi poochta hi nahi. So imagine what will the effect on morale. So my CO, when we had led this thing, he told me and prohibited that this jawan will not be evacuated because you will kill 5-6 more jawans. But then as a leader there, I thought it is a duty. I kept on telling me, sir, I can't listen to you properly. He said, no, but I can listen to you. No, I said, sir, I can't know what you are talking about. So I told him, sir, I am moving this man. So he told me he will be court martial. I said, fine. I have not been able to listen. And so anyway, so I took a decision that this man will be evacuated. Now, every Pakistani weapon was pointed at that. And the distance between their post and our post was 150 meters. 150 is hardly anything. You can take a pinpoint distance, especially from top. So I told my senior JCO what to do. I told him that there are like rocks, if you've seen, one rock to another, there is a place where you can hide behind rocks, but there is open space. So that open space can get you killed if you move between that. So, but I don't know what hit me that day. And in my life, we have something called a helmet. You know, you've seen those photographs. That helmet is, if you wear that helmet, it itself will kill you because that helmet is so heavy. So I never used to wear a helmet. You know, being an officer, I used to take that liberty. And my jawans were sick, so they had a pagdi, so they never wore a helmet. That day, helmet was carried. Before giving the orders, I wore a helmet. I don't know what happened. And I told my JCO, both of us will make a move from this rock, another rock, a distance of about 50 meters, and then another rock for about 25 meters. I said, when you move from here to here, the Pakistanis will suddenly get lost and they'll fire at us. And this jawan, we rang because every bunker was connected to some called a JWD cable, which, you know, that black cable. We rang him. I said, the moment the fire comes onto us, your job is to just rush back 15 meters and go down behind the rock, and then you'll be safe. Otherwise, there is no other chance. So he agreed. He says, okay. The moment he says, okay, now move, we moved from that distance of 50 meters. This chap moved down below. Pakistanis did not know what happened because they saw why these chaps are coming in the open. And before they could know anything, we were behind the second rocks. And this chap was safely down, and he was then walking, and the rest of the battalion would have taken over. We are not bothered. But the problem was we were stuck in a position where we could not go left or right, because still we had to cover 25 meters of distance. So now the Pakis were on to us, because if we don't move, in any case, we cannot stay for long on that behind the rock. So after some time, my JCO ran and jumped, and there was a tremendous amount of fire which has came onto the JCO, and he survived. And he thanked the Vaheguru ki bach gaya. Then it was my turn. Actually, now I was very, very scared as to how to go, because I was sure that now they will be firing very heavily, and they knew, and they kept on firing at that rock. So again, I remembered our God, and I ran. I think that day I must have defeated Usain Bolt also. You know, the speed was so much. And ran behind the rock, and while going just behind her, a bullet came and hit me on my helmet, and lodged in the helmet, and that helmet is still in my unit. And luckily, as they say, you know, it is in our Marathi, we call it Swadhin ki Daivadhin. That day I realized we are at the mercy of the God, and I was saved. So that was the second experience at a different level of service. The third was in 1992-93, the valley was full of terrorists. Every house had a terrorist in, and I was posted in Baramula, and we're told to sanitize, get rid of all the terrorists. And every day we should have some action, as Flight Lieutenant Shivali had said, I had a fortune or misfortune to kill about 22 of them personally by my company over the prolonged period. So in one of, my company was in one of the jungles, and they're all surrounded by jungles, nalas, hills or something. I was in a jungle away from habitation, and we used to carry out operation, and we used to kill all these terrorists, and we were quite notorious for it. So the terrorists had decided to cause incalculable harm to our company. But I think being our fellows, we are quite a step ahead of them, and we never got into their trap. So one day, there was one fellow from Afghanistan, he was known as Chacha Afghani, and we were after him. We wanted to kill him, and we made known that who sir gives the information will appropriately honor him, award him with appropriate amount of money. So one day, at about 3:30 or so, one of the sources are the fellows who give us information. He came to me specially, and he said, Chacha Afghani is in such and such village, about 6 kilometers away from our post, and it is in the jungle. You must have heard about Rajwad forest, very hub of terrorist activity. So I said, let's go. No, we'll never get such a chance. So I left about 15 people to guard my post, and rest we ran to the, we moved very quickly to that village, and then we had a system that all are congregated at one place, and we start searching. So all the inmates were gathered at one place, and we started searching for house to house as to where is hiding. After about 15 to 20 minutes of search, I found something, you may call it sixth sense or seventh sense or whatever. I found something amiss, and because it gave me eerie feeling as to something is drastically wrong. And why it happened, I really don't know. So I told my company, stop searching. They said, "Sahab, abhi to shuru kiya hai, kahin chupa hoga, iska aisa mauka kahan milega?" But I said, "No, just leave everything. Come at one place." And I had one second lieutenant with me. I said, "Jaswinder, you run with the first half, and I will follow you on the second, on the hillside, so that nobody can ambush us from both the sides, and reach the company headquarters as fast as possible." So, as good soldiers, the second lieutenant ran from the left side, I followed him on the right side to avoid the ambush and all. So we must have taken around half an hour. And when we reached, my company post was surrounded by about 400 people, 400 odd terrorists, and they're firing. If they have got at least 15 minutes delayed, their ammunition would have finished, they would have captured them, skinned them alive, and that was the methodology of terrorists. They used to skin all the people captured alive during this. That we saved, and that day alone in the firefight, we killed at least about 70 to 80 people, and our company got saved. So this is, now as a leader, what do you call? They say it is a sixth sense, seventh sense, or whatever, but I feel your hard disk gets the experiences and it gets stored in it. And there are responses. Your brain, your hard disk gives you at a correct time. And that is probably a sixth sense. And I feel that all leaders must have. And if you're going to be leader in the armed forces tomorrow, you should develop the sixth sense. Automatically, if you're sincere, you learn from your experiences, that will give you a sixth sense. So that was the sixth sense. I will give one more example and then I will move on to the surgical strike. And this is dedicated to, there are not very many girls, at least the ladies are there, dedicated to the girls and ladies of India, how brave they are. I was commanding a unit in Operation Vijay, and that time Operation Vijay had not started, and we used to carry out the line of control patrolling day in and day out. And General Anil will tell you, on the line of control, there are very many mines laid, right from 47. And the peculiarity about these mines laid by Indian Army is that none of the Pakistani terrorists blows his legs. It's only we step on the legs and we blow our own legs. But not this time we had to carry out the patrolling. So in one of such patrolling, a young boy, maybe 18, 19 years of age, Sukhinder Singh, I still remember his name, he stepped on the mine. And I was carrying on anti-terrorist operation about 50 kilometers away. And this chap was moved to the hospital and his leg had to be amputated. But this fellow, he didn't. He says, "Main apna pair nahi kataunga." So the doctor rang me, "Honor, we have a something called radio set. And on the telephone you can speak." So he spoke to me, "Sir, iska to pair katna hai." So I said, "Then cut to. Agar katna hai to there is, you can't help it, no? This is the fate accompli, as you call it." But he says he's not signing the willingness out of it. So I said, "Then what do you want me to do?" He says, "You speak to him." I says, why should I speak to him? Because not listening to the professional advice. Why should he listen? He says, "Nahi sir." He said, "Mere CO se baat karo, aur wo jo bolte karunga." So I said, "Theek hai." So I told Sukhinder, I said, "Sukhinder, aisa hai, and tere ko apna pair katna padega." And CO in the Indian Army is a big man. No, his word is like a God's word. So he said, "Theek hai sir. Aap bolte to kaat deta hu." So he got his leg amputated, I forgot this thing. Then after some time, after when I came and he came out of the hospital, I saw in the unit there is a system that whoever comes, he has to be interviewed by the CO. I said, "Sukhinder, tum bada aadmi hai ki tum professor doctor saab ki baat nahi ho raha, meri baat maane." So why I am giving the example is how that relations in the army are there. Isse saab, aap jab bachcha aaye the unit mein, 19-20 saal ke, aapke paas ek sahayak hota tha. So I remembered him. I said, "Haan, matlab wo Fakir Singh na." Maine bilkul, wo to uska main beta hu. So Fakir Singh ne bola ki bhai saab, CO saab jo bhi bolta hai, chahe jaan chali jaye, uska hukum nahi talna. And therefore I allowed you to cut my. So these are the relations which we develop in the army. And as they say, we die for each other or have a similar kind of dangers put in for this danger style. Corollary to this, continuation of this. Now this chap was about to get married. And he was to go on leave after about 15 days. And now his engagement was to be done. And then I told him, "Now Sukhinder, tera thabhi pair to kat gaya, abhi to tere saath kaun shaadi karega? Ye to engagement toot gayi." He said, "Theek hai sahab, jo hoga dekha jayega. Abhi to wo to hai mere saath shaadi to karega nahi koi. But theek hai, ghar mein jaake kam se kam chutti to kaat leta hu." To ho gaya, he went to his village, came back, and then after about 6 months or so, I get a request from this chap. "Saab, mere ko ek family quarter chahiye rehne ke liye." In the field area, we used to have about 15, 20 for a very, very serious cases which are in the back. So I was quite amazed. I said, "Iski to shaadi nahi hui, iske family quarter mein kya tu apni mother ko lana chahta hai kidhar?" "Nahi saab, main meri shaadi ho gayi." Maine kaha, "Wo kiske saath hogi?" "Wo usi ladki ke saath hogi." Maine kaha, "Good." So, and I forgot and gave him a quarter for maybe a month or two. He came and I said, when he came, he says, I said, I want to beat this girl. He says, Ashadhu. He says, Aptike. So, and I forgot. After about month, I was coming back again to the base from the forward area. I saw this chap standing with a girl, a beautiful girl, no, young girl of maybe 18, 19 years of age, and standing, and he says, yes, wo hai sab mere bibi. So I called her. Maine kaha, aa ja bete. I said, tum itni sundar ho, tumhare paas options the, dusre ke saath, iske saath, jiska pair nahi, uske saath kaise shaadi kar li tumne. So, you know what this girl says, saab, अगर मेरी शादी होने के बाद दूसरे इसका पैर कट जाता क्या मैं इसको छोड़ देती. सो आई वॉज क्वाइट अमेज एंड इन द हार्ट्स ऑफ हार्ट आई स्टार्टेड थिंकिंग इफ यू हैव गॉट अ सिटीजन्स लाइक दिस देन आई डोंट थिंक एनी पावर ऑन अर्थ कैन स्टॉप आर गोइंग फॉरवर्ड. सो दैट वॉज अनदर पर्सनल एक्सपीरियंस आई हैड इन द आर्मी. एंड द लास्ट वन आई टेल यू, I was at that time a fairly a senior officer. Many of you had come during my tenure in the core headquarters in Srinagar. Core commander was, the core commander? Shivali? Kumauni officer? Om Prakash. General Om Prakash was Kumpar. I was his deputy. And I was a major general in charge of South Kashmir, which you keep on hearing, Pulwama, Anantnag, Shopian, all these areas were under me. And for about 2 years I commanded this force and we neutralized all their hierarchies. There was no action, there is no incident in that area, and therefore they were quite cheesed off and they wanted to take revenge, and they sent a note through one of the porters. The porters from that area used to come working with us, the local porters. And that is written in Urdu. So one of the porters dropped next to my house, saw that I could see it. I just saw that this is written in Urdu. I told him, one of the chairs, I said, translate this. So he said that you have caused sufficient damage to us and before you go, you will be killed. Now, I just put that chit and I never told anyone. But I was not a fool. And hearts of hearts, we all are, you know, devotees of say Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. I mean, whatever, apart from our military training, I by and large used to follow his technique. So whenever I used to be there, visit any company, I never follow the same route. If I go a particular route, I'll come by another route. And I'll tell my security that we'll go a particular route, but I'll, at the end, I'll change. So for entire about a year, I never could, they could never catch me. Because if you have to ambush a person, you have to carry out a recce. Recce takes time, you have to plan, you have to put the people. So therefore you keep on changing your schedule, it becomes very, very difficult. And sometimes travel by helicopter, come by road, or mostly go by the helicopter. So successfully I completed my command, and on 13th of November 2013, I handed over my command to another officer, and then I was 14th of November, I was sitting in my house, and at 1 o'clock was my flight to Bombay, and then you have to leave about 11:30. So everybody knew that I'm going to leave at 11:30. I had my breakfast and sitting and reading a book. So one of my friends from the school was a brigadier commanding unit at the airfield itself. So he was saying, sir, so many time you have not come to my unit. Why don't you come and visit my unit? I said, nothing to do, let me go. So I went at 9:30 only. And stayed in it. At exactly 11:30, at the gate of my force, they carried out ambush. Unfortunately, there are about 4 CRPF people were killed, but I survived. Again, I feel that second time I said, your life as a soldier is not in your hand. If you have to survive, then you'll survive. If you don't have to survive, you'll not survive. So these were all the experiences. Now I will go on to the surgical strike part of it. Now before going on to the surgical strike, firstly, what is the background? What is the background of surgical strike? Firstly, a lot of people ask me, what is surgical strike? Why do you call it a surgical strike? Now plain, simple, layman's term, a surgeon, when he does a surgery, he has to remove a part which is troubles you. You have to get rid of it. So he goes inside your body, he tears inside your body, remove that particular spot, it doesn't harm other tissues, gets it out and throws it. So the aim is exactly the same. Surgical strike on the terrorist was, terrorists have to be removed without causing damage to civilians or their military. So therefore, the term is termed as a surgical strike. You may remember on 17th September 2016, the four LET terrorists carried out a strike on Uri camp and they killed around 19 soldiers and about 38 were injured. A very huge loss we had. And then we, again the same statement started right from Delhi down below, we are not going to forgive. And as the cliche goes that eat ka jawab patthar se denge, hum bhulenge nahi, and we are quite used to it. And Pakistan was much used to it. You know, 2016, what had happened? We'll teach Pakistan a lesson and do this and we'll get. But nothing, after 1 month, jaise the, all actions same, and Pakistan also says, ke, then we carry on again. And I think the maximum punishment we used to threaten them was that hum apna, aapka cricket khelna ban kar denge. With this kind of a reaction, Pakistan was quite happy, no? And it became a matter of fact as to continue like this. But this time our PM, I think on 18th of September itself, said that we will not let this thing happen and the perpetrator of this crime will have to pay very heavily. And we thought, of course, from, as I said, from Captain's Day, we are in such a scenario. We have been on line of control. We are facing Pakistanis. We are facing the terrorists. And we already had a aim in, or some kind of ambition, that we must get a chance to strike at the chaps. A strike which hurts them most. But by the time we come to such a scenario, we thought that, no, it will also pass like this. But we are quite surprised. And mind you, as when I was a core commander, we already had a plans ready. That if something happens, we will do something like this. And without knowing that, we will actually be given the orders. But I had told my, we had 19 commando detachment under me, including one para commando. And I told them, you are giving a target. You practice in this area as to how to go and strike. And tomorrow, if there is a chance, you don't tell me, sir, hum abhi tayar nahi. So as far as I am concerned, we were quite sure that if any chances comes our way, we will be able to carry out a task with a minimum of a delay. But at the same time, we are quite sure that no orders will come. But to our surprise, on 21st of January, the orders came that you plan for the targets. And we planned for about 7 targets. 4 in Srinagar area, 3 in my area, that is Jammu Nagrota area, and 1 was on the border. So about 8 targets were there, and we are getting equal opportunity. And we are asked how much time. And we asked for a week, maybe. And he says, we'll be able to do. He says, will it be possible? And it was possible in the sense, are people ready? Only you had to just, last moment, things have to be tied up, no weapons, equipment. Only good thing this time was, we are given very good weapons. We are given night visions. We are given best of the, we can say, helmets, not those helmets which I said, they were quite good helmets, good bulletproof jackets, disposable rocket launchers. The whatever we asked for was given to us. And then we decided to carry out a strike. And strike was planned on 28th and 29th night. Now, how do you decide when to carry out the strike? The most important part, and like if you take your, now since you know the history of Chhatrapati Shivaji, you see how, when did he carry out the strikes to keep a surprise? You take a, say, Kondana or Panha, when did he carry out a strike? On the dark night. So 20th, 29th was a dark night. And in our mythology, Hindu mythology, we say, Amavasya means dar ke rehna hai, Amavasya means koi shubh kaam nahi karna chahiye. But as an infantry soldier, when we carry out action on the ground, I feel dark night or Amavasya, as you call, I will always tell the people, it's Amavasya, aaplyala maitrini sarke aste. You know, ti jar aaplyavar prasanna asel tar kay karu shakto. As a soldier, we were very fond that we should have bad weather, we shot Dark Knight, because we are quite well trained for it. So accordingly, it suited us very well. That was one. Second was surprise. Now, surprise and deception in this thing was a very high order. You recollect on 29th of September, PM Modi had called for a press conference. And every press reporter thought it is going to be some, and the issue was raised 3-4 days before it has started that, no, we are going to abrogate the Indus Water Treaty. And everybody thought now there is going to be announcement and Indus Water Treaty is going to evolve. And all reporters came with the questions, ki how it is and what is going to water action. But in the press conference, you saw the DGMO saying that we carried a surgical strike. Absolutely, the Pakistanis were perplexed, and our journalists themselves were lost as to what this has happened. They didn't know what questions to ask. But Pakistanis never thought we'll do such a thing. No, in 15 June 2015, also we carried out a surgical strike in Myanmar. And that time, if you recollect, Pakistani Interior Minister had said, Bharat humko Myanmar jaise nahi samajhna chahiye. Hum Pakistani army. At that time also we, and not to boast and all, we always thought that we will teach you a lesson. We'll never say that you are a man. You are a Pakistani, we'll teach you a lesson like a Pakistani. And that we chance we got. And therefore, they were not actually, they never thought that we'll do it like this. And that was a accelerator. It was a help to us in carrying out those strikes. And therefore, on the line of control, their posts were not very alert. Though they thought that we should be alert, but they are not very alert because they thought that, you know, the contract of infiltration is only theirs. We cannot do it. Indian Army cannot do it. So therefore, we decided surprise was most important. Apart from this, we about the surgical strike in the entire India, only I think 15 to 16 people know it. At Delhi, three of us, two corps commanders senior, their helper, their assisting operating officer, BGSs, they, and the COs from whose areas the strikes were supposed to go. Only these people, so about 15, 16 people. And Delhi, I think PM and there are only also 5-6, no more than that. They are also not very many people knew it. So that was the surprise. In fact, so much so that my second in command, there is a corps that is called a chief of staff, who is the rank of major general. So when the surgical strike took place and came on TV, I was sitting nicely in my office, just enjoying the show. He came running to me, he said, sir, ye TV mein dikha rahe, ye strike hua hai, apne area mein hua hai kya? So I told him, agar dikha rahe, toh hua hai hoga. You know, but to tell you the fact that the surprise was maintained of a very, very, very high order. Then the last part of it was, how did we carry out the actual strike? And one of the portions we tell you, when you carry out a strike, we moved the teams from places by helicopter a day prior, way behind. And from there, they walked up to the launching points. Now, the most important part or most critical part of the operation is to infiltrate. And infiltrate distance between the two Pakistani posts at places, it is between 75 meters to 150 to 500 meters. So one of the places is just about 150 meters. And that was the only way we could go. And if you are detected there, then whole mission is finished. Once you are detected, you cannot carry out anything. So that is the most important part. And as you say, when the God is on your side, anything can happen. Fortunately, all my three teams and the common team managed to infiltrate successfully. And there was no radio communication, only the code words were there. After successful infiltration, particular code word. And throughout the night I was awake, I used to get only code word. In fact, my wife was there, he says, so she was used to all this thing. She thought, but he says, today it's a little more. So what happened? I said, something is happening, you know. So the code words came. There was a code word when they reached at the target end. And when you had to carry out a successful launch, that was, the time also had to be decided. And for my area, I had decided timing of 3:30 to 4 o'clock in the morning. And why did I choose this? Because if you find the human body is most sluggish and it's a deep slumber between 3 to 4 o'clock. And second, of course, in Indian Army, those who know, we are a very secular person. We do not differentiate between one religion. We respect all religions. But all these terrorists they are Islamists. And that day their first prayer, called Fajr prayer. Fajr, that was I think at 4:05, 4:05. And I thought that, you know, if you have to, you should not kill a person when he's praying. Therefore, we decided our operation should finish by 4 o'clock. And mind you, when this is all the people went on our target, they gave a code word. I said, carry on. They stayed exactly between 12 minutes to 15 minutes on the target, emptied all their weapons, and fired everything. In 15 minutes, they finished the job and collected and started their march back. Now, you don't compare with this picture, surgical strike, you know, that was a picture. It has to have some masala in it. You know, otherwise, it became a documentary, like they kept on searching for some fellow. You know, it doesn't happen like that, you know, in max, least amount of time. Or there is some actress who, you know, keeps on telling, giving guidance, alpha, but it doesn't happen. There is no actress in the forge, you know. But they immediately finished their job, came, and luckily, while coming back, one of the posts got alerted, and unfortunately, we had to kill their soldiers. About 3 soldiers were killed. And we came, they told me, we gave the report. They were brought to the team, main team, paracommandos team was brought to me in the morning to debrief. They showed me the entire footage, which is done by the night cameras. So that time, our bosses and the chief of army staff was General Suhag. He said, you must get it filmed. So I was quite irritated. I said, are we going to carry out a shooting there or going to carry out a attack there? You know, this kind of luxuries we don't have. But he said, nahi karo. And now after this, I realize what a good, great thing he told. Because after this, there are some people, most of the nation was behind us. They gave a pat on the back and felt that, yes, the army has done a good job. And we also felt very proud. There are 2-3 individuals. I think one was Kejriwal, another fellow in Bombay, Nirupam, Sanjay Nirupam, he says a surgical strike. So I can, even if it is there, this is your army. No, you should be proud of it. When you tell we had done something, you should believe it. We are not the ones who are going to tell lies. And these people are showing seeds in the minds of everyone that we are not carried out. What kind of an Indian you are? So that was one thing, one black spot which I felt that this shouldn't have been like this. But anyway, there are always exceptions to the rule, unless there are black chaps, you know, the importance of white will not be there. Anyway, so, but to say that we had carried out this and we did, entire operation was converted on a CD. There are 2 copies sent. Rest, the chief had come and he told in front of us to destroy everything. So we destroyed all, whatever we had filmed. And only 2 CDs, taken by the chief himself and deposited in the safe custody of military operation direction. They must be there. I think subsequently they were made public also. No, so it got proved. We came back, this officer came, showed me, I said, well done. The first call I got from Delhi, it was from Mr. Manohar Parikar. And he says, well done. And that was very great for him. We had, at the end of the day, we had all teams together. We subsequently gathered. We killed about 82 terrorists from 8 corners, and not a single life was lost from us. I think this is one of the most successful operations was carried out. And that was the end of surgical strike. Rest, if you want, you see in the movie, rest of the masala you can see, but the basics of surgical strikes were this. So that was the end of surgical strike. I finished my lecture here. I had taken about 3-4 minutes more than my allotted time. And now I am willing to take any questions, any kind of questions you want to ask about surgical strike or any experiences. I am open to all your questions. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.